Welcome to the latest edition of the High Pressure Podcast. My name is Jeff Beamish. I'm an air quality meteorologist at Sonoma Technology in Petaluma, California. And today's podcast topic, La Soufrière, the volcano that has been erupting on the St. Vincent Island. Two of my colleagues joining today.
Hi, my name is Patrick Zahn. I'm the lead air quality forecaster for Sonoma Technology.
Hi, my name is Steve Irwin. I'm also an air quality meteorologist with Sonoma Technology.
So as Jeff mentioned, we are looking at a volcano that has been erupting for the last several days in the Caribbean on the island of St. Vincent. And the animation that you are looking at right now shows satellite imagery of this eruption. And you can see this sort of dark gray cloud exploding into the sky. And that is the ash that is being injected into the atmosphere from this volcano on St. Vincent. And you can see the gradual transport of that ash cloud from the west to the east. Now, this presents a pretty challenging event for air quality forecasters. The ash that comes out of a volcano is a complex mixture of gases and particles. There's sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, CO2, and a mixture of a lot of different particles and different particle sizes. So we're going to be looking at this episode today just to see what's going on in terms of that ash production and its transport, and also trying to take a look at what some of the models have been showing us, trying to predict the air quality impacts from this eruption.
Important to point out as we dive into this topic here, just some of the nuts and bolts of what's been going on with this volcanic eruption on St. Vincent, because this has been going on, at least the buildup to this event has been going on since late last year when a lava dome began to form and expand. This volcano erupted on Friday. That would make it April 9th. April 9th is when this first erupted. And again, a series of eruptions has been ongoing since then. We're recording this podcast here on April 14th. One thing that we had talked about, gentlemen, with this event is sort of the rarity, or you really don't hear too much about this, volcanic eruptions in the Caribbean. And Steve, I want to bring you in. You found out some real interesting stats regarding volcanic eruptions and volcanoes in general in the Caribbean.
Yeah, Jeff, when I think of the Caribbean, I don't know about you guys, but I really don't think of volcanoes. I think of beaches. But in fact, the Eastern Caribbean has a number of volcanoes. I don't know if you care to guess how many there might be in the Eastern Caribbean.
I'll say
three. Let's go ahead and guess. I like that idea.
I say three.
I'm going to say six.
Well, they actually have 19 live volcanoes in the Eastern Caribbean. One of these volcanoes has been erupting continuously since 1995. This particular volcano, however, hasn't erupted for in 42 years. So many people on St. Vincent are probably experiencing this firsthand for the first time.
So to me, yeah, generational event, that definitely stands out. Wow, 19 volcanoes in the Caribbean. That's incredible. Who'd have thunk?
And one thing that I wanted to mention, just, I mean, we've been keeping this animation up for minutes now, but one thing I wanted to point out right away is just the fact that this plume of ash is injected way into the atmosphere. You can see a suggestion of it here right when it starts. You see the shadow of the plume against the lower level clouds. It's going to loop back around in a second, but right there. The other thing I wanted to mention here was that things seem to be moving in different directions in this animation. And that's true. The transport patterns are different at different heights in the atmosphere. So you see low-level clouds moving from east to west, that's right to left. But then you see the ash cloud from this volcano moving west to east. And so that the meteorology can be complex just in terms of transport, where you have different paths at different heights in the atmosphere that can make it difficult to predict where the plume is going to go. So I'm going to exit out of this animation really quickly and just talk about some of the air quality monitoring that's going on or not going on. So this is an image from AirNow Tech that shows the current PM2.5 monitoring network. And what you, I'm going to point out here, so that the volcano is right in this region here, and that's a very monitor sparse region, as we would call it. This is PM monitoring. If I go to SO2 monitors, and SO2 is one of those pollutants coming from a volcano, it's even more sparse. So there's not a lot of monitoring going on here. In fact, so these are AirNow monitors. I can go to Purple Air as well. And there are some PM monitors in Purple Air showing up in this region, but not a lot. And a lot of the ash is being blown out over the Atlantic Ocean, and virtually no monitors out there. So we don't exactly know what the air quality impacts are at the surface from this volcano. We've seen a lot of images and videos on the ground in St. Vincent showing just enormous amounts of ash falling to the ground. And my guess as an air quality forecaster is that particle levels are really high in the immediate vicinity and just downwind. They've been talking about impacts in Barbados, which is about 100 miles away, but we don't know exactly what those impacts are because we don't have a lot of monitors in the area.
Yeah, Patrick, one thing I want to point out here, if you go back to AirNow Tech, two things that we keep tabs on as air quality forecasters. First and foremost, number one, volcanic emissions in itself, while there are plenty of volcanoes around the Earth, eruptions of this magnitude are really few and far between. I think we'd all agree on that, right?
Yes.
Yeah. With that being said, there are places that do monitor SO2 near volcanoes. And the one thing that I wanted, Patrick, for you to point out is the dense network of SO2 monitors that exists in the Far East over in Japan. They have an extensive, just in general, they have an extensive air quality monitoring network in the Far East. And you're going to see that here momentarily. And I'll buy you a little bit of time here, Patrick, to get over there. There it is, right there. Those are all the SO2 monitoring sites in Japan, an incredibly dense network. Certainly there are plenty of volcanoes in Japan that, of course, feeds the need for that information. And one thing that we help out with, at least domestically here in the United States at Sonoma Technology, we actually do help run a website for the Hawaii State Department of Health, monitoring SO2 levels on the Big Island of Hawaii, this in relation to Mount Kilauea. So, with SO2 monitoring, it really depends on the area in which you're looking at. Here domestically, the Big Island in Hawaii is one place that has SO2 monitors, also in Japan as well. It just so happens in the Caribbean, that monitoring network just simply does not exist.
Thanks, Jeff. Yeah, and that highlights that often the monitoring network reflects the local or regional air quality situation in that region. So if they know that they have ongoing volcanic eruptions and that's causing an SO2 issue, like in Japan or Hawaii, then they tend to build up those networks to monitor the situation more closely. But that just hasn't developed in the Caribbean. And especially, they're not going to put up a monitoring network in a matter of days. One thing I did want to show in AirNow Tech was the aerosol optical depth from the MODIS satellite. So we call that AOD for short. And I'm going to go back to yesterday. So the darker orange and red colors here indicate that there are aerosols in the atmosphere in that region. So again, the volcanic eruption was in this area. You can see some darker reds off to the east, likely reflecting the transport of that ash cloud. Now, a couple of things to mention. This is what they call column depth aerosol. So it's measured by satellite. The satellite's just looking directly down at the Earth's surface, and it gets a measurement of how much aerosol is between that satellite and the ground. So it doesn't exactly tell you what's at the surface, but it tells you that somewhere in the atmosphere, there are aerosols. But the other thing I wanted to highlight here was that there is also some AOD, or aerosol optical depth, showing up off the western coast of Africa, and that is due to dust. That's wind-blown dust, and that's something that we see quite frequently there off the western Africa coast. But it's complicating the overall picture here in the Atlantic, because we have ash from this volcano. We also have dust from the Saharan Desert. So there are multiple sources here, and actually multiple, again, different transport paths. I believe the dust from the Saharan Desert is at lower levels being transported from east to west. A lot of the ash from the volcano is being transported at higher levels, much higher in the atmosphere. In fact, in the upper troposphere and even the lower stratosphere, and the transport direction at those heights is more west to east. So it is an interesting picture, even just looking at the AOD.
Yeah, two things here, Patrick. First and foremost, for those of you listening, watching, the levels that we're talking at here with this ash traversing from the west toward the east is somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 to 40,000 feet up into the atmosphere. So that's kind of just how this volcanic eruption, how much it's being injected height-wise into the atmosphere. Stephen, not to put you on the spot here, you had unmuted. I'm not sure if you had something that you wanted to add on to this, but floor is yours.
Oh, I just wanted to note, if you look similarly, if you look out in the western Gulf of Mexico, you can see some pretty high levels of AOD there as well. And that's something that's been very persistent over the last couple of weeks. And the cause of that, those higher values of aerosol optical depth, has been seasonal agricultural burning that's been happening across the Yucatan Peninsula into southern Mexico and eastern Mexico along the Gulf Coast. Each of those fires, when you see them on satellite, they're pretty small blips. But when you combine the effects of all those smaller sources, it can have a big impact on regional air quality, not only in the Gulf of Mexico, but we've also seen it along the northern Gulf coasts in places like southern Texas and Louisiana, where their particle concentrations have been quite high at times due to that smoke coming north out of Mexico. And so as we're thinking about, you know, this volcano on the scale of the globe is a rather small feature, but it's having a big impact, lofting ash and gases all around the globe, similar to how the seasonal burning can affect air quality, not just locally where it's happening, but far away from the sources themselves. And so those are all big challenges for air quality forecasters. There's a lot to keep in mind, different sources around the globe and how they can affect air quality locally in different places.
I'm glad you pointed that out, Steve. And I think that's a good bridge to the next topic here. Short term and rather near and, near distance and long distance impacts that this volcanic eruption is going to have, not only around the Caribbean, not only around St. Vincent and the Barbados, but as we're looking globally. And Patrick, if you want to, let me go ahead and pull up windy.com. I want to go ahead and show some of the modeling that's being produced by the Copernicus European model for SO2. Because obviously there are health impacts locally, and there's going to be some air quality and weather impacts on a large scale basis as well. And I'll bring you in on that.
Yeah, so one thing I wanted to mention following up on both of your comments, because this ash plume is being lofted well into the atmosphere above the lower levels, once it gets up into the stratosphere, that allows it to be transported even greater distances. Once the gases and the ash particles are up at that level, those winds can carry the ash and gases around the globe. And we're really looking at, thousands of miles of transport. And so the impacts can be felt worldwide if it's a large enough eruption. And that's certainly what this model is indicating, with SO2 production and transport across the Atlantic and well into Africa. We might see air quality impacts not just over long distances, but over long periods of time. So we're looking at days to weeks from this eruption.
Yeah, and I think also as we're looking, you know, large scale from this, and one thing that I immediately thought of when I first heard of this volcano erupting was Mount St. Helens back in the 80s, early 80s, that is. You know, you have SO2 among many other gases and particles being transported across a large area. But, you know, with this volcanic eruption, it's most of this is staying over the Atlantic, right? With Mount St. Helens and that eruption back in 1980, that ash plume was all pretty much carried right over the United States, to the tune, just to check my source here from the Washington Post, an article written back in 2016, the Mount St. Helens eruption actually lowered the global average temperature by about 0.1 degrees Celsius during 1980. So certainly that's one of the long range impacts that a volcanic eruption can have, well away from the source.
And one other thing that I wanted to highlight with this, even though we don't have that type of situation, I mean, we're looking at transport across the Atlantic, instead of across land and highly populated areas. I did want to, just highlight that there are some very real impacts for people living on St. Vincent and nearby Barbados. Thousands of people have been evacuated. Obviously, there's ash fall, a lot of ash accumulating, impacting their air quality. Also, they're having issues with their water supply, possibly being contaminated. They're having power issues. And all of that, in addition to the very real ongoing danger of the eruption itself and pyroclastic flows. So there is a very real impact in areas near the eruption.
And the impacts of SO2 on the local population there, just in reading from some local sources there, they said that folks have been experiencing wheezing and shortness of breath, hard to breathe outside. Folks are taking refuge indoors, and I think that goes back to much smaller scale, but still important to talk about as we're heading into our ozone season here in the US as summertime is upon us. A lot of those effects that they can feel with breathing SO2 and the issues that causes for people with respiratory disease and also existing heart disease. Those are the same issues that we talk about when we're forecasting ozone. Here in the summertime, that folks need to be aware of the air quality forecast in their local area, and especially folks with asthma or COPD or other or heart issues, that they would have a plan in place for those days when ozone is going to be at higher levels here going into the summer.
Yeah, and that's a great point, Steve. You know, just the local impacts it is having on St. Vincent and Barbados, because, you know, we've looked and we've seen plenty of videos, you know, on being shared on social media of the ashfall in these spots. And while it, you know, you look at it and it looks like there's snow falling and everything, I mean, that's, you know, that's a very real danger. I mean, it's a very visible danger. Compared to here in the United States or in populated metropolitan areas, you know, ozone's invisible. You don't see it, right? So you don't quite know exactly what you're breathing in because you can't see it, but still it can be very, very harmful, you know, heading into the summer months here in the United States as, you know, temperatures warm up and we see ozone production increasing. So no, that's a great point about, you know, just the health impacts that, you know, these pollutants and these gases can have on humans.
So just to wrap up here, we will be monitoring this situation as it evolves and looking at the long range impacts, especially related to air quality. But it is a complex situation. And any time there's one of these sort of exceptional events, the situation can change from hour to hour, day to day, and it really does require close monitoring to get a good handle on it. But this is a really interesting situation, and we will track it as it evolves.
Absolutely. So we appreciate the time that everyone's taken to listen to the High Pressure Podcast and watch our screencast as well. You can follow us on social media on Twitter. We're at High Pressure Pod. Or if you'd like to see some of the amazing work that we do at Sonoma Technology, head over to sonomatech.com. My name is Jeff Beamish.
I'm Patrick Zahn.
And I'm Steve Irwin.
Thanks for watching and listening to the High Pressure Podcast.